Thank you very much. It was a particularly deliberate decision of my own to come and speak here today. I'd like to take the opportunity to congratulate the small group of people who were here, numbering no more than seven, last year, and who have steadfastly and quietly and with considerable maturity for young people. I remember when we were young, we didn't have half that maturity, to have built their organisation to the point where it is today, and to have taken on once again that personal and collective responsibility that comes, in the words of Fintan Lawlor, of being the somebody who somewhere and somehow decides again to make a new beginning. I think it's a very, very courageous thing to do. I think it's a very necessary thing to do. And I hope that the organisation will grow in strength. Men seriously outnumber women at this particular gathering, but hopefully by next year that will change dramatically as the numbers grow. These are very interesting and very sobering and very painful times for Northern people to live through. We've just come through some 30 years of war, troubles, whatever people want to call them. And so I'm mindful as I stand here today that I have no doubt that when James Connolly and Pierce and McBride and all of the others finally got together and took a decision to make a stab for the Irish Republic, that sitting in a chair with his legs broken, waiting to die, was not what Connolly had in mind. That joining his comrades in a quicklime grave and being remembered for glorious and immortal failure was not what they had in mind. And sometimes we forget that. It's not the purpose of the 1916 Rising to give us a blood sacrifice of brave but few men. Sometimes that's the way life turns out. And so in the North, for us, those of us who have survived, those of our lost people that we loved, those of us who have seen people we loved live and suffer, the consequences not only of death, bereavement, but also isolation and being discarded for not following the path of moral righteousness chosen by the majority of our swell comrades. It's a painful experience. And yet we have to recognize that life's like that sometimes. And we have to get over it. Can't spend the rest of our lives complaining about what somebody else did. Can't spend the rest of our lives saying it shouldn't have worked out this way. That after 100 years of sacrifice, we deserve better than Bertie and Martin and Ian. We really did. That doesn't make them bad people. They have to, I think, take some step back and ask ourselves some bigger questions, because it keeps happening. It's not the first time that those who would lead us to the Socialist Republic took cold feet or had a better idea halfway along the road and decided to go somewhere else. So we have to ask ourselves questions. I mean, is it some particular gene in the gene pool that causes it to happen? Or do we have to stand back and make a serious political analysis of the weakness in our own organisation, in our collective thinking, and in our revolutionary understanding of what we have, what we want, and how we get from here to there? In a way, it's not our fault, but it is if we keep letting it happen without studying for ourselves how in this new beginning we can make things different. If we go back over 100 years ago, the first movement in this almost unbroken wave was for home rule. To come after a period of the famine, you begin to see the movement of land acts and land leagues. Start to realize that there was a general understanding amongst the mass of the people in every class that until we separated from the British Empire, we would not have the means, we would not have the power to solve the least of our problems. And so we all had the problem at the same time. And home rule was the first big project. It is the home rule project that is nearly completed. That's all. I looked in the Irish News the other day and I saw Jim Gibney, now a journalist with the Irish News, former revolutionary, for me always a friend, and one time a comrade. And I'm not sure what made me sadder. Jim Gibney had written in the paper that at 11:23 on the 8th of May 2007, partition had effectively ended and Ireland was free. And I wasn't really sure whether I should be sorry for Jim because he believed it, or sorry for Jim because he wrote it not believing it. But part of me thinks he believed it. And there's a thinking that goes to say, the party is the people, and the party has got its backside in power in the north and maybe at some time in the south, and therefore the people are in power. But what they have effectively achieved is no more than home rule in a partitioned state. And perhaps the promise, not that I want to, in the sunshine, cause people to become depressed. But I have no doubt that by the time we celebrate 100 years of the 1916 Rising, and certainly by the time we come around to 100 years of the treaties, the home rulers on both sides of the border will be suggesting reunification in one unitary state with home rule within the Commonwealth. And the South will be asked to join the Commonwealth so that the North can come home to a unitary state and the British citizens of the North not feel isolated. Take my word for it, that's where the home rulers are taking us. Slow learners, 100 years, and Lloyd George will have been proved correct. It's actually not that important. What is really important, are the other two issues. Not about a measure of home rule under the wise guidance of British monarchs and British empires, but understanding the politics, first of all, of republicanism, which is not an Irish ideology. We didn't invent it. The great leaders of republican ideology are Thomas Paine, and I would recommend everybody here who has not read The Rights of Man to go and read it, to understand the basic fundamentals of republican ideology, which starts with the self. The great tensions in republicanism, they start with the self, not with the collective. And they start with the realization that responsibility for the individual self lies with the self. And we have responsibilities to each other. And they challenge the right of monarchs, and they challenge the right of gods, and they challenge the right of churches to tell us what we should be and what we should think and how we should put our lives together. Because the core tenet of republicanism is individual conscience. That's how the Methodists got in on the act, and Presbyterians and all of that. But republicanism is an ideology that recognizes the core rights of individuals and the collective rights of people. And it argues that no matter how long a usurpation of rights exists, it remains a usurpation. and it remains the right of the individual and the right of the people whose own rights have been usurped at any time to collectively work to get them back again. And it retains within that right, in the last analysis, should all else fail, the right of the people to take up arms against oppression. That doesn't mean it's always a good idea. That doesn't mean it always works. But republicanism is about rights. Democratic rights, the rights of delegated authority, and the right of the people to take that authority back. That's a bit sometimes we forget. That's a bit our leaders forget. That's a bit the people who would be the power brokers forget. The people have the democratic right to take away from the politicians, to take away from the power brokers, the authority to represent them that they gave them at any time. The people have the right to abandon the party. The party has no right to abandon the people. And that's a lesson that we have to learn. Republicanism is a very broad church. It's about how authority and power is delegated. It's how society is democratically put together. And so you can have a bourgeois republic. You could have a conservative republic, like the United States of America. You can have a small farmers, small swindlers and dodgy envelopes republic, which is what we have in the South. You can have a dodgy diesel and smuggled cigarettes republic, which is what I think we're heading for in the North. Or you can have a democratic socialist republic. And the difference in what kind of republic we build, the difference in what kind of republic we have, is in whether it is a socialist republic or not. Socialism is fundamentally an economic philosophy. It's not particularly Irish either. But all of these things are concretized within the context of our lives. Socialism is very simple. Socialism is a doctrine, an ideology, a thought that asks a simple question. How can one human being amass great quantities of wealth from the labor of thousands? The wealth of the country belongs to the people who produce it. And there is not a penny. There is not a euro. There is not a pound. There's not a brick upon a brick. There's not a factory. There is nothing on this land or beneath it that is not the property of the working class of Ireland. And therefore everybody else who owns it has usurped it from the people. How? Not that I would want to pick on a law-abiding citizen, but how does Sean Quinn sleep in his bed at night? And how does he say his prayers to his God in the morning, knowing that he's not much older than me and he has £2 billion? He didn't earn that by blood, sweat and tears. He hasn't lived long enough to do enough labour to make out of the sweat of his own brow £2 billion. He made it out of the sweat of yours and mine and all the other people. How can people own the wealth of this country? How can shares own anything? How can people in Dublin own property worth millions of pounds? How can land be owned? Land that is millions of years old, be lived and owned by human beings who only live to their 75 or 80. That's what socialism is about. And it's not just about the rhetoric. Just imagine how much work we have to do to reverse the situation whereby the greatest number of people on this island are poor, and the smallest number of people on this island are filthy rich. How much work do we have to do to reverse the situation that when we talk about politically removing the authority of a worn-out empire from our right to make decisions, that almost every blade of grass, almost every brick, almost every single means of the production of wealth on this island is owned by somebody whose feet never touch the ground of this island? That's what we're talking about when we talk about socialism. And that's why we can't do it on our own. We're not any different from the people in Scotland, Wales, England, Iraq, anywhere else, who don't own their own life. Don't own their own life. Don't own the means of production of wealth in their own country. Can't make the decision because they don't have the power. That's the task you have set yourself, setting up your revolutionary party. If you thought it was for a spin round the pub, if you thought it was for a tour round next year's commemoration, if you thought it was maybe safe to start a party now when the noise has died down, I know that's not what you think. I've watched you for a year. You're a fine group of young people. As fine a group of young people as I've seen in 30 years. And I remember all the young people who've come before you. Some have grown tired, and some have grown old, and some have grown wise, and very few like myself have just grown old and are no wiser and no better and no tamer and are not for quitting. And maybe some of these days will join you. I wish you success. Thank you.